you, Marty.
Well, Carl, thank you. Now, after spending 12 years with one organization, I had a great deal of respect for Leon Hess and everybody that I played with. But the biggest part of my life was the fans and the players that I had a chance to go out there and win every Sunday with, or we lost every Sunday, but we had a great time for 12 years.
Well, the NFL's lost, the New York Jets lost, retiring after 12 years. Welcome aboard on the Sports Channel team. I know you got to run upstairs and join Barry for the second half.
Thank you, Carl. And Barry and I are wondering when you're going to start working down here.
I'm going to start working as soon as he goes back upstairs. Barry's probably up there drinking a soda listening to all this. I'm going to get one when we go to a break, and we'll be back with the start of the second half when we return to Hofstra Stadium in Hempstead, New York.
It entered our homes 50 years ago. It was television. Then came cable. And the good idea got even better. A few channels became dozens.
Well, here I am again with a chance.
Satellite technology wired us to the world with 24-hour movies, news, sports, and music.
Hello, cable system.
I'd like to order the fight, please.
Innovations that will come together in 1992.
To complement NBC's network coverage.
The Olympics triple cast. Three separate cable channels. In addition to the NBC network broadcast, commercial free, all the best events, 15 days, 24 hours a day. The Olympics triple cast, another cable triumph.
Back at Hofstra Stadium, Barry Landers along with Carl Reuter and Marty Lyons as we get ready for the second half. Let's take a look at our schedule. We told you we had a dandy coming up for you, and here it is. Next week, next Friday night, Iona and St. John's will renew their hot rivalry. Iona, an improved club. Billy Highland is healthy this year. And then on September 28th, you'll see Hofstra once again taking on CW Post, Tom Marshall's Liberty Conference championship team. Friday, October 4th, back here at Hofstra when Buffalo comes a-calling. And on the 12th, Harvard and Fordham. We'll get a look at the Fordham Rams. Larry Glick feels his team is vastly improved this year. Hofstra and Fordham, a heated rivalry, renews on October 19th. Then Post and St. John's on Friday, October 25th. Those two clubs have had some great games in the Liberty Conference. And the following day, we'll be back here at Hofstra for Lafayette, another Patriot League team coming in. Then November 16th, Fordham and Holy Cross. And then we'll wrap it up, of course, also with a final regular season game here at Hofstra. Portland State, a team that played in the playoffs last year against Hofstra, playing the Flying Dutchman. So we get set for the second half right here. And we want to remind you folks that this fall on Sports Channel, baseball doesn't end when the World Series is over. That's because Sports Channel is bringing you baseball's greatest games. You can catch 24 of the most dramatic Major League matchups from the past four decades, including Game 6 and 7 of the 86 World Series, and Nolan Ryan's sixth no-hitter. Baseball's greatest games coming in October, exclusively on Sports Channel. Waldo Shansky getting ready to kick off to start the second half. Hofstra with the commanding 34-0 lead. Line drive kick. Walsh will follow that ball into the end zone and will dive on it, downing the football as all the blue shirts there swarming around Matt Walsh. So near perfect first half for Hofstra. Specialty teams, the offense and defense all coming up big. And we'll see what Mr. Kelly and company can do here in the second half as he heads onto the field. The economics major from Beaver, Pennsylvania. Kelly in the first half was 7 for 18 for 74 yards and one interception. 6,249 here in attendance. Inside handoff and not much of a hole as Hofstra smoked the play down very quickly. Mike Gifford, fireplug, 5'11", 285-pound sophomore from Seagate, New Jersey. They call him Heavy G. I wonder why. Hartnell making some changes here. Mark Harrison coming in with a play from the sideline, part of the big crowd. Dave Bernardinelli lines up, wide to the right, bottom of your screen. Out of the I formation. quick out. And Berardinelli drawing double coverage, run out on the sideline. Rizzo, and also on the play, getting some help there from Barrett Boyd, the cornerback. Marty, what do you think, Lou Marin? As Carlin, you alluded to, it's got to be awfully tough, your first game down 34-0. What can they do here to establish something for the next game, thinking ahead?
The biggest thing they want to leave this game with was respect. This is a gut check for Bucknell the second half. We're already 34 points out of the game. They may be out of the game completely. At least build something to take into next week's game, build some confidence.
Matt Walsh with the reception out of the backfield. Billy Deacon's on the coverage. Walsh won the Outstanding Sophomore Award last year, playing behind Brian Hennessy as a tailback. They employ him as a pass receiver quite a bit. Hennessy will replace Walsh in the ballgame right now.
As you can see, Jeff Kelly and the Bucknell offense, they're going conservative. They want to eat up some clock to keep that explosive Hofstra offense off the field.
First and 10 at the 32-yard line for the Bison. Hennessy met in the backfield and taken down. Billy Deacons with the penetration, number 41.
Billy Deacon has had an excellent game so far, a big first half. He's been that leader that the defensive unit has been looking for, especially after losing all three linebackers last year. Billy Deacon is emerging tonight as that leader.
They say he runs to the ball like a madman.
Well, right here, Barry, this is not the first time Billy Deacon has come right through the offensive line without being touched, but he's stopping Brian Hennessy with negative yardage.
Second and 14. Hennessy will try the right side this time. Gets by Javinski, has the first down and more. Rizzo trips him up. But the best run of the ball game for Brian Hennessy. Remember, he needed only 37 yards to break the 2,000 mark, and I believe with that run, he is now over 2,000 yards.
Well, you have to commend the man for that kind of effort. He's led Bucknell the last 3 years in rushing. He's now the third all-time leader, but he wants his team to win. That's the most important thing for Brian Hennessy tonight, is to make his team win. He's got 13 carries for 49 yards. I'm sure he'd give up all that to see his team come back.
And the inside handoff, not much there for the fullback, Jeff Wall. Wall stopped after maybe a one-yard pickup. As the clock ticks early here in the third quarter, Hofstra leading it by a score of 34-0. 34 points, by the way, in the first half is second in the record book to the 38 points that Hofstra scored against St. John's in the first half in 1990.
They do put points on the board, and they do come quick.
Second and 9. And blitz coming. They picked up Brown's blitz, but overthrown as the pass to the far side. Again, Varick Boyd with quick coverage on Dave Berardinelli, setting up a 3rd and 9 situation.
Barry, the one thing that's hurt Bucknell's offense all night long is getting in the 3rd down and long situation. They're never in a 3rd and 1 or 3rd and 2 where it's a run situation. They're always 3rd and 9. When they did get in the 3rd and 1 and the 3rd and 2, Hofstra's defense rose to the occasion and stuffed them.
The linebackers love that 3rd and 9 situation. You have so many options. You can blitz, you can do a lot of things.
Don't be surprised. Joe Guardi will send the linebackers right here.
Draw a play, and Hennessy into the secondary. Tripped up. Otherwise, he might have gone. Varick Boyd tripping him up. Saw the explosiveness of Brian Hennessy up the middle right there. He hit the hole very quickly and picked up 22 yards.
Here it is. It's a simple handoff up the middle. Excellent blocking by the offensive line. And once Brian Hennessy breaks through, he wants to get that positive yardage. He wants to get his team on the board. He's given every little bit of energy that he has.
First and 10 at the 28-yard line. Bucknell trying to get on the board for the first time. Wall to the 25 and to the 24, about a 4-yard pickup. Vince Gallion on the tackle.
Let's go,
look at the junior fullback, Jeff Wall, who saw limited time last year. Quick and strong. Not a big guy, 188. Second and 6 as Esposito and Berardinelli line up at the top of your picture. Hennessy. Lewis Brown dives inside the 20, appears to have the first down. Akinnuwi brought him down. See where they mark the forward progress. It's going to be shy of the first down, I believe.
Well, what we're seeing here is Bucknell running a conservative offense. They're trying to build some confidence, trying to get back some respect within their whole team. Going in at halftime, being down 34-0, there's not much you can say. You have to say, guys, hey, it's a gut check. Let me see what you're made of.
Bucknell will play Villanova next week, and in 2 weeks we'll play Fordham. And Kelly doesn't like what he sees out there, so he will come over to talk to Lou Maranzana. With 10:37 to go here in the third quarter, Hofstra led it 14-0 at the quarter. Tacked on 20 unanswered points in the second quarter.
Well, as we look at it, Barry, this has been the most consistent drive that Bucknell's put together the whole night since the very opening drive, and then they fumbled. But they've moved the ball almost 80 yards. They've eaten up 4.5 minutes of the clock. And the big thing is they've kept the run and shoot on the sideline.
And that is a critical factor. You know, Hofstra, you look at them, many games last year, the other team had more possession time. But Hofstra ended up outscoring their opponents and set an NCAA record, scoring 47 points, giving up only 9. That margin, 38 points, was the most in NCAA history.
Well, as we saw in the first half, there was Mark Cox had that 80-yard touchdown run, one play. They had the blocked punt, three plays later, touchdown. They had the big turnover by the defense. Four plays later, touchdown. It doesn't take this Hofstra offense that long to score.
This drive, as you were pointing out, has been a good one for Bucknell. Their best, certainly, of the game. They've gone 10 plays, 58 yards, and they've eaten up almost 4.5 minutes of the clock. Third down and 4 from the 22. Walsh tripped up. Good play by Akinnuwi, and Gifford wrapped him up, but it was Akinnuwi who got into the backfield to just slow down the play and leave it for Gifford to finish it off.
Akinnuwi just made great penetration. He turned it back into Mike Gifford. Mike Gifford being, he's a big boy out there. 5'11", 285. And then all he did, Barry, was body slam.
First start for this plugger, Mike Gifford. Very strong, enthusiastic kind of kid. Fourth and 5, and they will go for it at the 23. Esposito wide to the left. And again, Kelly will call a timeout. So something in that Hofstra defense is bothering him as he calls a second timeout on this drive. Under normal circumstances, you know, wasting timeouts in this spot, you'd be very upset with. But they want to make sure that, this drive pays off at something. Not looking to save these timeouts for the end of the game. They may mean nothing at the end of the game.
Well, 34 points behind, you want to get one successful drive into the end zone. But using two timeouts this early in the second half could haunt them when they really do need the other timeout.
Offensive coordinator over there talking things over with the Bisons, and we'll have our second timeout here. Discussion goes on.
Everybody's got to suck it up for one play. Look at the time to run off the clock.
Mike O'Connor has finished his discussion with Jeff Kelly. Try to get a report on Beisel's hand from Carl Reuter down in the field to find out if he will be back at all. Really no reason to play him the way that Dodo has done, the freshman, but
I wouldn't expect Joe Gardy to play him, but I would like to see, you know, get the injury report to let people know.
Kelly under great pressure eludes Santanello. At the 20, dives forward and appears to have the first down. Vince Gallion brought him down, but let's wait. Let's see where they mark the football. Close, but Hofstra may get the football back here.
Joe Gardy will be happy with his defense there. He's got a philosophy, bend but don't break.
Good job, guys, good job.
Hofstra gets the ball back. First time they'll have possession here. And there's a look at Michael Dodo, who in the first half came on 5 for 12 for 85 yards and two touchdown passes to Scott Millington. Connolly with the reception. And the guy they call a Smurf, little 5'8 guy, makes the catch. Bobby Marshall on the tackle. Hofstra threw the ball 33 times in that first half. And here's Connolly with the reception here.
That's a lot of wear and tear on that defense out there.
Connolly came from the scout team to win a job with some great catches, diving catches. Oh, look at the move put on Marshall. And a first down for Wayne Morris. A little shake and bake move right there, and John Tillman with a tackle. But we have another player down, and that is Blaine Fawcett, the strong safety. Report on George Ruccino, a broken fibula. Now Fawcett down, that secondary really having some problems with injuries tonight.
You hate to see that any time in the season, but especially the very first game. These players have worked hard during their training camp, school starting. They want to win tonight, and now to go down with an injury.
Fawcett, who probably is the best athlete in the secondary. As they work on it, let's hear the sound.
Make a move, Lino. There you go, buddy.
You know, it looks like Fawcett could have possibly just had the wind knocked out of him.
Maybe hit that shoulder when he popped Morris there. Well, let's go down to the field, see if we can get a report from Carl Reuter.
Well, Barry, we'll follow up on that after we talk to Carl Ulrich, who is the commissioner of the Patriot League, a league in which Hofstra has a lot of interest in getting into. And Carl, you have to be very impressed with this Hofstra club tonight.
Well, sure, I'm Carl, and as we were last year, we're hoping against Fordham. No question that Hofstra can play football in the Patriot League. There's no question about that.
So when would a decision be made then? They have obviously the criteria to get into the league. Now what is the next step?
Well, I think this is a presidential decision by the Council of Presidents of the Patriot League, and they're the ones that will make that decision. I do think that with Navy coming in this year, that there's some feeling that the league wants to sit a little bit and kind of see how things work with eight members, with a great athletic director that you have, and Jim Garvey, and of course President Shuard, who epitomizes everything good about college athletics. So it's going to be hard to say no.
Carl, if the ball was in your court, would you vote for them right now to get into the Patriot League?
Well, I don't have a vote, Carl, so I don't know that I should answer that question.
All right, well, we appreciate you coming by and talking to us, and good luck with the Patriot League, because it's been a real good one so far.
You bet, Carl. Carl, you're tied into a great outfit here with Hofstra University.
Thank you very much. Carl Ulrich is the commissioner of the Patriot League. Barry, let's go upstairs, and we'll check out that injury as well.
Mark Cox with a 13-yard reception. First down for Hofstra. Michael Dodo up the middle, overthrowing the intended receiver, Ray Barberite. Roosevelt Smith with some pressure on the quarterback. One of the few times that Hofstra quarterbacks have been pressured tonight.
Well, Dodo's coming out and playing with a little bit more confidence than he did the first half. I think he's settled down. He threw two touchdown passes in the first half. He's getting used to the offense. He's still shading his eyes a little bit, trying to find out that signal. But he's looking much better this half.
He's 8 for 16 for 112 yards and a couple of touchdowns. This time on the ground to Al Hagofsky. And the power runner shows some ability to turn it outside and picks up the first down. Gets about 14 before he was run down by John Spatafore.
Joe Gardy said, anytime you run the run and shoot, if you have a quality running back like Al Hagofsky, you can run the ball.
Well, they have a lot of depth at that super back position. They've got Cox, Hagofsky, Driver. Alex Austin, who we haven't seen yet tonight. Dodo to throw on first down. And knocked down on the far side. John Tillman with the drop. The real good-looking linebacker. 6'4", good size on the outside linebacker. He's got good range. Clock stops with 8:25 to go here in the third quarter. Hofstra with a commanding 34-0 lead. Dodo dropping it off. Morris the first down. Morris to the 22 and shoved down. Wayne Morris wide open on that crossing pattern.
The one thing Wayne Morris is going to have to do is if he knows he's going to get hit like that, he's either going to have to put the ball away or do one of those hook slides like the quarterbacks do in the NFL. He can't go into a defensive back standing straight up.
Morris, 7 receptions for 80 yards. And looking for number 88, Michael Wright, the little speedster from Florida. Now Hagofsky trying to provide a little bit of blocking. A.J. Carvelli. The coverage. As we mentioned, Michael Wright has been a favorite of Joe Vardy. A young man with 4.56 speed. Converted running back from Iowa and Kansas State were interested in. Dodo overthrows little Bobby Connolly. He's at 5'8". And setting up the third down play here. Signal will be set in. We saw Manny Mitsakis on the sideline there, the offensive coordinator, along with Kevin Keefe, the running backs coach. Morris, tip and incomplete. A little better touch on that. Morris would have had it. He tried to come up with it.
Well, I think that's the first time that Dodo really felt the pressure and threw a ball up for grab. Wayne Morris was wide open. He had to get it off because he had the pressure. Put a little bit too much loft on it. It's going to give his field goal chance. His team the first opportunity to kick a field goal tonight.
It'll be a 39-yard attempt. Olshansky kicked one field goal last year, a 44-yarder. Cox the holder. Again with the new upright at the new goalpost this year, almost 5.5 feet shorter. This one blocked at the line of scrimmage. Does not matter. Bob Marshall breaking in with the block, number 9, along with Hugh Woodward. So Hofstra's drive is thwarted midway through the third quarter. Joe Vardy has a word with his young kicker.
Barry, the one thing you want to see when your club is down 34-0 is which players are going to lay it on the line. Bob Marshall comes in, lays it on the line, blocks a field goal, and gives his team some momentum, but he's showing the coach, no matter how many points behind we are, I'm not quitting. I'm still going to try to win, and I'm going to give it my all.
That Bucknell coach Lou Maranzana likes the attitude of his club. Told us before the game today, it's a very cohesive group. Walsh driven out by Vince Gallion. As they keep it on the ground here in the second half. Bucknell, in case you're just tuning in, was driving for the first touchdown of the game when they fumbled the football in the end zone. Hofstra recovered as Vince Gallion has apparently got a cramp. He'll be worked on the sideline. And that was a turning point in the game. First play after that, 80-yard run by Cox. It's been all Hofstra since that point.
Exactly. That broke Bucknell's back.
And despite losing their first and second string quarterbacks, Hofstra has put points on the board here tonight. Kelly on 2nd and 5. Pressure. Throws to the sideline, and it'll be completion. Appears to be shy of the first down if they mark it at the 30. Set up a 3rd and 1 play. Berard Nelly with the catch. He's been a Dean's List student every semester he's been in school. He's a junior.
Barry, it seems like this is a totally different game from the first half with all the enthusiasm that the Hofstra offense brought. Now we're watching a Bucknell offense that just wanted to earn a little bit of respect.
By the length of the football, they made it. So Bucknell will keep it going here. You know, when Hofstra did this against Division III teams last year, and they did it to everybody, as we mentioned, the margin of victory was enormous, 38 points per game. You know, this is the way they did it. They were up so much by halftime, you could go home as far as the second half was concerned. But tonight, they're doing it against a 1AA team, which was 7-4 last year and was ranked in the top 20 of 1AA teams midway through the season.
Well, I think that's a credit to Joe Gordy and his organization here, how hard they've worked to put this team together to play 1AA.
Kelly showing good speed as Deakins was chasing him from behind, could not get him. And Kelly out of bounds at midfield with a 19-yard pickup. It's been the best part of Kelly's game tonight, his running ability. He's pretty quick at the corner.
Well, you know, coming off that knee injury, I'm sure, you know, as we talked to him today, he said that he felt that he lost a little bit of his mobility, but he, you know, he didn't want to use it as a crutch. He felt very confident in what he was going to do. But tonight, he looked a little shaky at points. He went back there. He didn't have the patience that he needed. But then again, Hofstra's defense, they're on top of him.
Out of the I formation. Hand off to the fullback, Ronnie Maceros. And he'll pick up about three, maybe four, as he gets close to the 46-yard line. Jim McManus, number 59, substitute tackle, making the stop. One of the juniors getting a chance to play right now. Very strong kid who has switched from offense. See if there are any other substitutions on that defensive line. We see number 99, Charlie Santanello, still in. Jeff Brown, starting middle linebacker, as we watch from our end zone camera. Down from behind by Santanello, and Jeff Wall brought down for a loss on the play.
Santanello just made an excellent tackle. Had the running back got to the corner, he could have picked up the first down. Santanello comes across, beats the offensive tackle, grabs him around the waist, and just pulls him right to the ground.
That was a Marty Lyons kind of play. You used to do that.
When you were healthy. I would have probably tried to slam him a little bit harder.
Nice guys play football, especially defensively, right? Kelly under pressure from Galleon, and Pate makes the reception. Where has Jeff Pate been all night, the 6'6 All-Patriot League star?
Well, we talked about what Lou Manziel said today about how he's got great hands. The only thing he doubted was his blocking ability. Jeff Kelly stayed in and took an excellent hit and still got the ball to his receiver.
Pape at 6'6", 235 pounds, a great target. So Bucknell with another first down here from the 33. That's Esposito in motion. And again, Tennessee, no room. Makes a nice move to the sideline. And driven out, stopping the clock inside the 30 of the 27. Steve Javinski, the strong safety, running him out. He's the best hitter in the secondary.
Brian Hennessy went from making negative yardage to picking up 7 yardage with just one little stutter step. He took a stutter step right here, freezes the defense, and then goes back out, gets an excellent block by his offensive line, picks up 7 yards.
Yes, he's had a good second half and hopeful of reaching the 100-yard mark. And was held to 29 yards in the first half. He's got 80 yards right now. Kelly looking for six. He's got Berardinelli out there, but he can't hang on. He fumbled the football, and they're going to call it a touchdown. They say he had possession in the end zone. Hofstra can't believe it. Barrett Boyd ripping his helmet off and saying, "I can't believe it." The Bisons have not been shut out in 51 games. And Joe Gordy saying,
"That's a big question mark, because I know in the NFL the ground can't cause a fumble, but right here we've got to find out: did the receiver have possession when he hit the ground?"
27-yard touchdown pass, Kelly to Berardinelli. The extra point by Justin Frick. Bad snap. Remember, you could score 2 points in college football on the missed kick. However, Berardinelli recovers. He was the holder. And the try for the extra point goes for naught. Oh, into discussion here. We may have an offside call against Hofstra. Joe Gardy, who played high school football in New Jersey, coached at the University of Maryland.
Offside, defense, repeat the try.
Yeah, they'll get another chance.
Right here, they must have lined up in the neutral zone because nobody jumped on the defensive line. It had to be lining up in the neutral zone.
Gerardinelli, why don't they go for two at this point? But they want to give Frick a chance to kick here, I guess, and get ready for the rest of the season. And he puts it through the uprights. You're trailing 34-6. Why not go for two? Let's watch this controversial play here.
Right here, Jeff Kelly drops back. He throws it. Receiver makes an excellent catch.
Gerardinelli,
he catches it. I don't think he ever had possession.
Well, that one will be an interesting. Had this game been a lot closer, boy, Joe Gardy might have taken it a little different.
Boy, me, Barry, Joe Gardy would have.